Your Excellency, thank you very much for this comprehensive overview of what happens in Africa and what should happen in Nigeria. Maybe you can prepare it, right? I'll take advantage of being the chair of this discussion to ask the first question. You know, we are living here in a small country with with four or three different racial and cultural differences, or groups with differences. And this is something that is actually quite difficult to manage. I mean, you have been running a country with how many?
Tribes.
Tribes, yes.
Well,
and how do you get some national identity out of such a varied group of people, tribes or differences, different ethnic backgrounds or whatever?
I think we have at least 350 tribes. 350 tribes. And then two major religions. If you will count the religions, I don't know how many, because in our traditional religion, I can be worshipping a stone, another one can be worshipping a tree. So how do you forge unity or commonality? Or how do you reduce the problem of diversity? What I first understand is that diversity by itself is natural. And if you understand and you realize that diversity by itself is natural, I think for a leader, that is the first thing to identify and to accept. The second thing is that if diversity is natural, then you must accommodate the interest of all the diverse component of the people you are managing. And where to start is in your own household or your own office. Now, if you come to my office, and I am a Yoruba by tribe, mm-hmm. and all the people you find in my office are Yorubas, because I don't trust other people who are non-Yorubas to be in my office, then for what reason should other people trust me to run their own affairs or to be over them? So if you come to my office, if you find 10 people, you won't find more than one Yoruba, at most two. So that when you come and you find an Igbo man and you find an Hausa man, or madam here is he comes from minority. You are laughing. Now, the number of people in your tribe, they are not more than a million. But they are important in the scheme of things. And they must be regarded as important. And they themselves must regard themselves as important in the scheme of things. Now, and one of the things that I try to do, even in my living government, is to make sure that we have a minority person, when the opportunity arose, to be elected as leader of Nigeria. Because we have three majority tribes. Between the Yoruba, the Igbos, and the Hausa Fulani, they can handle the, they can continue to transfer power to themselves without caring about the minority. Now, I believe that that will be dangerous for Nigeria. We have had a minority, whether it performs well or it does not perform well, that's a different issue. But the point is that we have shown that a minority man from somewhere in Nigeria can also be elected in his own right and run the affairs of Nigeria. And we have therefore got over that hurdle. So what is important is acknowledgement and making every tribe, every unit or every component of our overall population feel that they have a stake and they feel important. I think that is, and it's no more than that, really.
Well, I hope it's that simple. Yes, I see several questions. I'll start over there and come here. As I mentioned, as was mentioned, please mention your name and eventually affiliation.
Good evening, sir. Babai Kabo. My name is Oluwaseun Fakwade. I'm a Master's of Public Administration student from the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. I have two basic questions. The first thing is, seeing the diversity that you mentioned in Nigeria, my generation, I'm 32 years old, suffers from ingrained ethnic divisions that seem to stem from the wars that you bled and fought for alongside the current president of Nigeria. My first question is not dwelling on the past, but how we can make inferences from the past with a view towards the future, which I'm a part of. My question is this: what would you do in your role as an elder statesman and as an influential person in the political landscape of Nigeria to start elevating discussion amongst young people and amongst the different, very divided ethnic groups in Nigeria? That's the first question. Second question is, if you look at the past 8 years, I don't want to go into details of the disintegration of your economic reforms, especially. We would see that the quality of leadership in a nation, in any society, would determine to a large extent the transformation of that society. I'm not trying to make an indictment on your decision of our former late president, who I will not speak ill of. But
man, don't forget that you voted for him.
I did not, sir.
Nigerians voted for him.
Yes, they did, sir. Right. So here is my question, and this is also going forward into the future. I consider myself as one of the promising leaders of tomorrow, and but I would say that the stakes against people like me are very high because we have a political elite that is vicious and that is cyclical, and to a large extent will not permit the rise of young, inspiring, and transformative leaders. So what would you do in your position, seeing that you play a very pivotal role in the political landscape of Nigeria, to allow for the emergence of young, articulate, capable, competent, charismatic leaders? Because
thank you. Let me deal with the last question first. Young, capable, charismatic,
competent
Nigerians must come to Nigeria and be part of it at home. Now, please, 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 it's all right you being here, with all due respect.
Baba, I just came here. Yeah, and okay. I was participating in government.
Can I
was director of communications.
Yeah, yeah, sorry. Yeah, you come back home. Now, you ask, when in my cabinet,
yes,
I had Obi Ezekwesili.
Yes.
Under 40. I had Frank Nweke. Under 40. I have Nenadi under 40. Rufai,
yes,
under 40. These are young. I went out looking for them. And some of them are still there. Because you have to. Don't stop complaining. Come in. Come in and fight it and fight for it. Now, if everybody, because one thing is that you must be capable and also be willing. If you are capable and you are not willing because you are afraid, this you can use all the grammar in life to describe these people. You can't wish them away. You have to get them away. If they will not go away. Now, but if all you are doing is, yes, they are there, they are not this, they will remain there. When I found that Jonathan is incompetent, absolutely incompetent, the first item or the first purpose that I want him to serve to show that any minority can be elected have been served. But then, question of performance. If you are not able to perform, get out of the way. I stuck out my neck and I said, for now, no more. I knew that I was taking a risk. And he himself said, if he has a second term, I will know that there's somebody like called Goodluck Jonathan. Now, and I said that if God is there and he knows that he's not performing, then he will not have a second term. And he didn't have a second term. Now, if I haven't stuck out my neck, Jonathan will have been there today. He will have been there today. So so it's all right. Now, then you talk about diversity. The Yorubas didn't vote for me in 1999. And they are second largest tribe in Nigeria. For whatever reason, they didn't vote for me. Now, when Nigerians decided they will vote for me, the vote of the Yorubas did not prevent, or the non-voting of the Yorubas did not prevent me from becoming president of Nigeria. Now, the lesson from that is this, that it doesn't matter what tribe you are, big or small, your tribe alone cannot make you chief executive of Nigeria. And it doesn't matter what tribe you are, big or small, if Nigerians want you, and your job should be for you to make Nigeria want you. If Nigeria wants you, your tribe cannot stop you. Or any tribe, for that matter, alone, cannot stop you from you being the chief executive of Nigeria. That is the lesson we have learned. And that lesson should stand us in good stead. So, come in. And don't be afraid. Now, don't follow some of those who will get penipni and follow the line of least resistance. You stand for what you are. Stand for what you know. And most of those young people, the like of Obi, the like of El Rufai, they speak out their mind. And that still doesn't stop them from getting to where they have to get to. Or the like of Soludo. They speak out their mind. I'm not talking of the mercenaries that you know.
I had a second question here.
Hi, thanks again for having us. My name is Ola Olani. Two hopefully quick questions.
Which organization or which? Which organization are you from?
Sun Edison, which is a renewable energy company.
Yeah.
So two quick questions. One on Boko Haram, which obviously has been Nigeria's biggest security headache in recent times. It's widely believed that the actions of countries like France and the US in Libya directly contributed to the militarization of Boko Haram in Nigeria. Now, my question is, you know, how does a country like Nigeria and the rest of Africa balance its relationship with countries like the US and France, who are obviously, you know, very important trade partners, with the sort of actions that lead into, you know, that result in the effects of potential destabilization across the region? That's
one. Can I limit it to one question per person? I think that's fair.
Fair enough.
Right? Boko Haram.
Boko Haram.
Sorry.
Well, before destabilization with the NATO forces in Libya, Boko Haram has been in existence. The situation with Al-Bash, what do you call the one in Kenya? Al-Shabaab in Kenya has been in existence. Now, what can we do? I think AU has to be strong. AU is not strong enough. And AU is not strong enough for three reasons. One, you need some leaders within AU that really can stand their own. Now, when AU said to the international community, we have a roadmap for dealing with Libya. The international community did not listen to AU. If they had listened to AU, AU had already started the process of getting Gaddafi out of the way. And that would have kept Libya secure and stable. The weapons that are now unaccounted for, some of which have found their way to Nigeria, to Cameroon, to Mali, will have been properly taken account of. But one, AU has to be strong politically, one, militarily, and two, financially. AU is not strong at all financially. I was appointed as chairman of a committee to look for alternative funding for AU. We look, and if they have accepted it and implemented it, AU will have got between $750 and $800 million every year. The contribution of member states does not even pay for the administration of AU headquarters, let alone to undertake any other thing. And I give you an example, Ebola. When Ebola came, AU chairperson got 100 people from all over the rest of Africa who volunteered. They wanted to go to the three countries ravaged by Ebola. She had no money. Here are people ready to go. She had no money. And when she told me, I said, look, all right, if you ask our development partners, they will give you pledge, but that pledge will probably take another year or two to come. So call our own private sector. He called them, and she got $40 million. That was when she was able to send these people. So we have to be strong. We have to be strong politically. We have to be strong militarily. We have to be strong financially. And if we are able to do that, we will. Now, Boko Haram, the new administration in Nigeria decided this is no joke. The last administration decided, well, Boko Haram is a group of riffraffs. Riffraffs, they tie a belt of gunpowder around themselves, hold a detonator in their hand and blow themselves up and blow other people off. Nigerians love life. You know them. Now, whatever makes a Nigerian, man or woman, young or old, to commit suicide, you have to look into it. You have to look into it. Nigerians love life more than that. And now, it's getting military upper hand. And that is good. But then getting military upper hand, the Boko Haram will not be resolved through military. Military upper hand will prepare the ground to do what needs to be done. Socioeconomic development in the areas affected. Let me give you an example. This is 2012 statistics. Education. In Southwest, 79%. In Southeast, 78%. In Northeast, which is the breeding ground for Boko Haram, 19%. That speaks for itself. You don't need to start looking for what are the causes of Boko Haram, because that affects everything. Employment. It affects your lifestyle. It affects everything. And I believe that once you start doing that, and the present administration understands that, they have to do socioeconomic development, and you win hearts and minds, you will get there.
I had a question over there, but the lady has disappeared.
He answered my question.
Okay, yeah. Who is? I'll take one question there and then the one in the back. Keep your question short and only one.
Right, Transdema, Singapore. Burundi, Rwanda is beginning to boil again. You have mentioned the situation about the artificial boundaries that had been given to Africa continent, and OAU accepted that in the charter. My question is being the elder statesman for Africa, is there any serious thoughts about making sure that the natural boundaries of the African people that have kept us at peace before the artificial boundaries were drawn? Do you think, even in Nigeria as we speak, the Boko Haram issue, if you go to Niger, the country ahead of us, there are still some Fulanis in Niger. If you go to the West, Republic of Benin, you know there are some Yoruba speaking across the border. We have the Bakassi issue, South Nigeria. Because of these artificial boundaries that we have acquired from, is there any thought of OAU really addressing this matter so that we can move forward? Thank you.
Yeah, let me answer that in 2 minutes because
there's another question. Yes.
Let me answer that in 2 minutes. I think you are confusing Burundi and Rwanda. They have now become two separate countries. In the colonial days, they were jointly administered by Belgium, and they were called Rwanda-Burundi together. Now, the country you are worried about right now is Burundi. Now, the problem of Burundi is this, politically. When Nelson Mandela intervened and tried to settle them, they agreed that the first election of the president will be by the parliament, but that will be the first election. The second and subsequent elections will be the constituency level, will go out. Now, what they did not put in the constitution clearly is that that first election is also as valid as the subsequent elections. So the president said, look, that first election that I had, it was giveaway. So don't count that as my first term. It's the one that they all Burundians elected me. That is the one that I take as first. And the other said, look, you were there. This was what it is. Now, he wouldn't agree. Now, that was the problem, basically. And then he did what, again, coming to what I said earlier on about AU being strong. You see, in the constitutive act of AU now, no country can divide AU because AU has right of intervention. then you can move to your country and take over. If you start running your country badly against your own people. Because what we said is that, look, these people are not just Burundians. They are Africans. And since we are all Africans, we will protect the life and property of any African in any African country. If the national government cannot do it, or if national government. So Burundi said, if any African country soldier lands on his country, he will regard it as war. And then everybody was cowed. They are behaving like a chicken beaten by rain. Now, how can Burundi, of all countries, say that and that stands? Because AU lacks the required leadership and the required means to do that. Now, you talk about original boundary. There was no boundary before colonial power. There was no boundary. I could move in those days. If you were there and I was there, we could move from Ibadan to across what is now the artificial boundary, go to see our kith and kin in K2 on the Benin border, or to Togo. There was no boundary. Now, what I believe you should be saying is that, look, if there are the possibility of the Yorubas in Benin joining the Yorubas in Nigeria, and the Yorubas in K2, or the Fulanis in Chad joining the Fulanis, I don't think that is the issue, quite honestly. For me, what is important is, first of all, integration, economic integration of Africa. That is very important. Secondly, of course, that it will follow. If you have economic integration, you will have political integration. And if we have political integration, even the minority within a country becomes the majority within a country becomes minority within Africa.
I had a question in the back there, and keep the question short, please.
Okay, Christian from PhD student at NTU. I'm from Republic of the Democratic of Congo. First of all, I would like to thank the Excellency for being part of ceasefire agreement in East of Congo. My question is very short. Like, actually, Africa, we have raw material, we have manpower, but we don't have technology. Technology is cheap. But in your view, what is the missing element for the development of Africa as a whole and for the Nigeria as a country?
The question is that Africa has people and raw materials, but perhaps not sufficient technology. What do you see as the most important step that needs to be taken to increase the development of the economic development of Africa?
Simple. Two things: education and leadership. Two things: education and leadership. Now, if you have education and your people are not, and you have poor leadership, you won't get far. If you have good leadership and your people are not educated and armed with skill, you won't get far. Now, what has made this country? Education and leadership. This is a country that has no resources at all. Education and leadership, and the two must go together.
I think I can take a last question here. Yeah. Sorry, can you wait for the microphone?
My name is Tola Amadeng. I work with the Australian Taxation Office. It's more like a recommendation with a little bit of question. So like what the gentleman here said about people with talents, knowledge. So like what His Excellency said, knowledge sharing, your know-how. It's not about saying what you know. I have a social page where people discuss, but nobody takes action. A few of us are willing to take the action to sacrifice, leave the life we have here or in Australia to contribute. But in reality, as much as I want to, with the passion I have and a few of my kind, I can't quit my job, even though I'm working for the Australian government. I have so much knowledge, so much skills, experience, and passion. So I have ideas about starting like a little ad hoc or group. But how do we go about this, sir? For people like us, what do we keep in? We can't just quit our job and go to Nigeria. I agree we need to be there. But how do we go about this? We can start something from here.
Well, thank you very much. I think you raised the question and you answered it.
Now, how do
please,
you start?
Please. How do you start? Dr. Obaje, how did you start?
Can you take the microphone, please?
Initiated the Nigerians in Diaspora Organization in 2000 in Nigeria, and you went around all the country of the world to bring together Nigerian experts who are based everywhere to come together under what you call NIDO. And that organization, you know, is still in existence, and Nigerians, you know, everywhere, including Australia, Singapore, we have Nigerians, in that belong to this, and that has really helped Nigerians to come together. Of course, if you were not willing to contribute, if you just went to, you know, then NIDO is not for you. But I think His Excellency has done very well in bringing Nigerians, experts in the diaspora together, and that organization is still alive. And anywhere you are, you come together and form yourselves together, and the government is always willing. In fact, every year, experts from Nigerian in the diaspora are invited home to give, you know, to meet their counterpart in Nigeria, whether it's at the university, in health, and some of us have been many times. Thank you.
I just tell you what they have done very well. I met doctors when I was president. I met doctors in UK. They couldn't go, but they were contributing money to be able to establish a first-class hospital in Nigeria. That is what NIDO was doing. Now, I don't like this spirit or this attitude of resignation. What can I do? Nobody will spoon-feed you. With all due respect, what can I do? You can't go to Nigeria. In Nigeria is your home. So you expect somebody to send you a letter of appointment here. Now, what can you do? Look, let me give you the story of my own son. He went to Cambridge. He had a PhD in electronics, and he was being dragged to America to teach. I said, well, don't go to America. Come home. And he came home on his way to America. and listen. And then when he came, I said, oh, Oshun, good idea. Why don't you join me on the farm? I said, farm? Daddy, I spent 7 years learning to become an expert in electronics, and you want to put me on your farm? No. I said, well, okay, try. And if you don't like it after 6 months, you can go. This was when I was still military, I was still elected president. That's 11 years ago. He's still on the farm with me till today.
Thank you very much for this. I have to stop here this conversation. I know there are lots of questions left, but we are already over time. I took quite a few things away from this discussion, too much to summarize, but the three or four points that I just want to mention is what strongly came out of the interventions and out of the introduction was Africa is successful the moment they take their own fate in their own hands and don't leave it to others. That is also a plea for a stronger AU and an AU not only with a good agreement, but also with resources that can actually implement the agreement. We saw also the passion of His Excellency for coming up for your own opinion. And it was not, there was no doubt about it when he was challenged that he really was coming up for his opinion. I also pick up the point that economic integration is important and that perhaps it is not a question of political boundaries or geographical boundaries, but it is a question of how can we integrate Africa better and create perhaps at the same time not only a national identity, but also an African identity. And finally, which is something I 100% agree with, but to be successful, we need education and leadership. We believe in that here at SMU. Thank you very much.